God created Satan. He was the head leader of worship. But you know what? He got fired. He got kicked out. So we're here to take his place this morning. So everybody, do your best. Worship the Lord. Love him. If you have a need this morning, he'll meet it. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we just come to you this morning. Father, we just pray that our hearts would be open to receive what you have for us this morning. As we just give you praise, as we give you glory, Lord, we pray that you would receive it, Father. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Worthy, worthy, worthy. I am split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescued me and I will stand and see. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescued me and I will stand and sing. I am a child of God. I am a child.
Hallelujah. Ever since I walked into this place, I could feel the presence of the Lord. The Lord is here. He's here to set you free. He's here to heal you. He's here to do a mighty work in your body and your mind and your emotions. Amen? Y'all can be seated. We're going to continue worship and tithes and offering this morning. Miss Joanne, I'll be in Philippians 4, starting at verse 15. I'm shaking, I feel it. So the Lord has a word for somebody. I'm going to take it for me. You can take it for yourself if you want to. Hallelujah. Okay, it might be on the screen, it might not, but you have a Bible or a smartphone, and it's Philippians 4, we're going to start at verse 15. It says, you yourself also know, Philippians, this is Paul speaking to the Philippians, right, that at the first preaching of the gospel after I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving but you alone. Amen. This giving and receiving right here, that's a spiritual law of the kingdom of God. Remember, we talked about laws a little bit last time. And remember, law's not to bind you. The law's to set you free. And the law of giving and receiving, amen, we see that. It's a foundation in the kingdom of God. 16 says, for even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for my needs. 17, not that I seek the gift itself, but I seek for the profit which increases to your account. Paul knew what kind of blessing the Philippians were going to get since they sent him a gift, right? And he was happy because he knew that the person giving was going to be fruitful and the Lord was going to multiply back to them. But I have received everything in full, verse 18, and have an abundance. I am amply supplied, having received from Epaphroditus, excuse me, what you have sent, a fragrant aroma and acceptable sacrifice, well pleasing to God. Paul was excited and overwhelmed for the people that sent him the gift. Amen. And 19 says, and my God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. And that's the promise that comes with the law of giving and receiving. Amen. And so the Lord brought this scripture to me this week. I was visiting with my mom and we were talking about the Lord. And I told her my heart is that when I come and minister in tithes and offering, that you will feel my heart and know what it is that I want for each and every one of y'all. Because I come up from a long legacy of spiritual women, right? My grandmother started a church. She taught my mother on tithes and offering. And it was really, you know, we were visiting, and I said, Mom, I wish the people would feel my heart. And Mom says, well, that's a given. Tithes belong to the Lord, and offerings where the blessing is. And I just thought about that for a minute, and that's where I came to this scripture. And so the Lord wants to bless you in a great and mighty way, but you have to have faith and do what the Lord asks you to do. And also what brought me to this scripture was that probably next week, as you all know, we're going to have an evangelist here, and you're probably going to be asked to give into his ministry, right? And we want to support those ministries. Here, Paul, he built these churches. He was the Apostle Paul. He birthed these churches, and the only people that gave into his ministry and helped him meet his needs was the Philippian church. I think some of the other ones did, but these are the ones that gave him a little bit more. And he was overwhelmed because he knew what the person giving was going to receive. And that's where I'm at, because I'm overwhelmed, because when you give, I know what the Lord has for you. And I'm going to share this little testimony with you so you'll know what I'm talking about, because the Lord showed this to me, and my mother brought it to my attention. And we have a legacy of tithing. My mother, me, I taught it to my children. My children are teaching it to their children because it has great blessings. In 1995, around the middle of the 1990s, the Lord impressed on me. He told me to get out of debt. And so me and my husband got in agreement, and I said, we need to get out of debt. It took us 3 years, and we finally got through, and the Lord showed us a lot of things during that time. He strengthened us, and he grew us, right? And so in 1998, we started our business. Where my husband worked, he had been working for 25 years, and they sold the company, and my husband did not want to go into working for a big corporation. It was a family-owned business, and it was sold to a corporation. So he said, it's time to start our own business. And we started in 1998, and praise the Lord, next month, we've been there 20 years, so we're celebrating that. God's been good. And so we began, and I worked for the state at that time, so my husband quit, and I continued working. And as some of you state employees might know, you only get paid once a month. And so God knows what's in your future. So he had already told us, get out of debt. So I was able to afford the household expenses with my income until we started getting the business to grow, right? And so one Sunday, I was in church, and it was the middle of the month. I had 2 more weeks till the next payday. And I had already given my tithes at the first of the month because, you know, that comes to me, it comes right off the top, right? It's the first thing. That's why it says the first fruits, right? And so at this time, I'm sitting in the pew, and there was a missionary that came to the church, and they were talking, and I just felt in my heart I had to give. I just, you know, how many of you know that the Lord puts this heart desires in your heart, right? He's the one that gives you those desires. So I opened my checkbook, and I looked down at it, and I only had $16, and that was to last me 2 weeks, because the business was only a few months old. And so I looked at it, and I started to reason in my head, and I said, okay, I can give $10. I have $6. Back in that day, you can buy a gallon of milk and cereal and bread probably with the $6. And so as I looked at it, you know, the pastor had called the ushers up, and they were up in the front, and they were getting ready, getting the plates, because they were going to pass the plates around, and the piano music's playing, and I'm looking down in my checkbook, and all of a sudden, silence came, and I looked up to see what was happening, and all I saw, I was wrapped up like in a bubble. It was a clear bubble. And I looked up, and I could see the people moving, but I couldn't hear anything, what was going on in the church. But I heard a voice, an audible voice. It's the first time and the last time that I heard an audible voice. And as I was looking, it just overwhelms me because it's just the presence of the Lord, so forgive me, right? I was looking at my checkbook, and the Lord said, "Do you trust me? Or do you only say that you trust me?" That's a loaded question. And after what the Lord had brought us through and everything that he taught us in those 3 years of getting out of debt, I said, I remember looking up at the ceiling and I'm going, "Lord, I trust you." And then, you know, then the veil or the curtain, whatever was there, I just felt like I was inside of a big balloon that was clear and I could see. So I wrote out my check for $10 and I gave it that morning. That afternoon, after church, we got home and my sister-in-law drove up. And I told my husband, "Oh no, we've got company and we don't have anything to share with them food-wise," because it was lunchtime. And at that time, my in-laws, they were getting together on Sunday mornings for breakfast because they were working on their relationship, brothers and sisters' relationship, and they kept inviting us, but we kept telling them we can't come on Sunday morning because we're committed. We have a commitment to the church and we have obligations. So we went. So when we got home and they drove up, they explained that morning they were at breakfast and they wanted us to share in that. So they decided that they were going to come to our house for lunch, but since we weren't there to have a say, they decided they were going to bring all the food. So I said, "Come on in." So we had a feast. They showed up with steaks. They showed up with, you know, my sisters are great cooks. They brought all kinds of food, rice, beans, chips. I mean, we had a big old feast and, you know, just 12 packs and all kinds of Cokes. The real thing, Coca-Cola. And then some of the brothers and sisters owed us some money, so they decided they were going to pay us back that day. So by the time they left, our refrigerator was stocked because we had a lot of steaks in the freezer because they didn't use all the meat. We had leftovers, we had sodas, and we had $221 that they paid us back, each one. The Lord is good. You can't tell me that tithing and offerings and giving doesn't have its rewards. There's promises in the Word of God. And that's how the Lord showed it to me. And he wants to show it to you. So when you feel in your heart and the Lord's asking you to give something and you thinking, "That's out of my comfort zone," trust God, because he's trying to teach you. He's trying to get something to you. Because if tithing and offering takes faith, but it's powered by the grace of God. And once you're obedient, you open that door for the Lord to bless you. And it's a promise in his word. Amen? And that's my heart. I want you to be blessed. I know that, don't get me wrong, you know, if you're not a tither and you just give whatever, God loves you because you're a child of God. But these promises, these things in the word of God has great promises for you. And that's my heart. Because I feel like y'all are my kids. All of y'all, some of you are older than me, but that's okay. You're still my kids because the Lord has placed you here for a plan and a purpose. Amen? And that's my heart. I taught it to my kids. I taught them to be tithers, givers, and they are, and to stay out of debt. And I want to get that across to you because I love you. Amen? I hope y'all feel me. Let's pray for our offerings. Thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, because you're so awesome, Lord. You're a good Father. And Father, I thank you for my brothers and sisters, Father, that you will reveal to them, Father, that they would get in the Word and that you would reveal to them, Father, your promises, your laws, Father, that are set them free, Father. Lord, I thank you for their jobs, for their businesses, Father. I pray that they would have increase, Lord, as you give them wisdom and revelation of your word in with tithes and offering, Lord, that you would open those doors, Father, that those promises would come over them and upon them, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that if they that their soul prospers and they're in health, Father, as that they're healthy, Father, and they're prosperous as their soul prospers. And Father, that's what we're here for, Father, to prosper their souls so that they can go out into the world and lead others to Christ, which is your commandment, Father, that your great commission. And Lord, I pray a blessing over their jobs, their finances, Father, that you would multiply to them, Father, that you would show them, Father, God, show them how much you love them in the matter of finances, Father. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. You went off.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you to Pastor Sally for that wonderful message. That was a great testimony. So for those of you who have been part of this church for a while and we see the blessings, the promises that the Lord comes through with, just look around you and look at how many people are blessed here. And we follow people that teach us the right way. We become just as blessed. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I've got a few announcements to start off with, and then we'll get started with Pastor Kyle's message. So the first announcement is going to be that you can find us on YouTube and Facebook for all of our events and services. So the Sunday service and Wednesday night Bible studies are all on Facebook and YouTube. Our midweek Bible study is on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. We have the Spanish and English session along with children and youth services. So if you're not part of that, come on down. Be part of that. We're right now working on you've already got it, one of Andrew Womack's teachings. We're almost done with that, but I heard we've got some good in store. So keep coming, go along for the ride. It's a good one. Wednesday night, 7 p.m. Next Friday, the 27th, we're going to be leaving the church. For those of you who signed up for the baseball game, we're going to be leaving at 5 p.m. The game's at 7, so I think we figured if we left at 5, we got there enough time last year to enjoy the game and get our snacks together. So this Friday coming up, we'll meet here at 5 and then head out. Sunday, July 29th, next Sunday, we're going to be blessed with Pastor Jerry Garcia, who's coming up from, is it Mexico City where he's at, or down that way somewhere? So there you go, Hidalgo. Pachuca Hidalgo. So Pastor Jerry Garcia is going to honor us and come up and visit with us and speak to us. And for those of you who haven't got a chance to see him, he's a blessed man. He's a wonderful minister. He practices in the faith of healing, and it's just amazing watching him work and listening to his message. So come on down. We're going to have a potluck afterwards. So if you want to sign up for any food or snacks or drinks, there's a list in the back for whoever wants to help out and bless the church with that. Bring friends. Invite friends and family. I've reached out to tons of people already. So let's let them see how blessed we are by, you know, following these ministers who are just amazing. Amen. The next announcement I have is for Wednesday, August 1st, next, which will be the following Wednesday, 6 p.m. back to school party for all the youth here. We're going to do pizza games. We're going to start that at 6 p.m. and then go into our Wednesday night Bible studies at 7. So bring your kiddos, bring the grandkids. Come on down, have some fun before school gets started. Thursday, August 2nd, the youth trip, the preteens and teenagers are going to be going to Six Flags. So we'll be leaving that Thursday morning. We'll have more details as we get a little closer. But $65 a youth, so if you haven't paid, it's going to be due before Wednesday the 25th. Just get with Pastor Bianca or Kyle, and they'll get with you on that. Sunday the 5th, we're going to be doing a backpack handout service during service to all the kids that are signed up for that. So if you want your child or grandkids to get some school supplies, receive some school supplies, and be blessed, sign them up. We'll get them their school supplies. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Prayer for every Sunday night in August is the next announcement. Lockhart Schools is holding that. So check the bulletin board. There's one in the back for times and locations. James 5:16 says, "The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much." And we want our kids to be wrapped with God's favor. Amen. and we want them to be blessed, and we want them to be safe. So if you can come out as a community, just come out and just put your part in prayer and pray for them. If you can't make it, that's fine. But, you know, just keep all of our kids in prayer, because they go to a public school. They go to a place outside of our home, outside of our immediate care. And we want them to take what they're learning from us here and practice that in the world. Amen. Last announcement I have is going to be November 8th through 11th. In the winter, the women are going to be going to Woodland Park, Colorado. All right, let's get a hand clap for that. That's going to be Thursday through Sunday. That's the equivalent of what the men do in January for the men's trip. So it's the Woodland Women Arise Conference in Woodland Park, Colorado. If any women want to go, sign up in the back. Get with Pastor Sally for details. It's amazing. I mean, I think you all should go, right? Just go and be blessed. If you're able to, if a work allows, sign up. You know, it's in November. We've got several months to get ready for that. This isn't on here, but I'm going to say this. As men, we're going to do our part, and we're going to raise money the way we did for ourselves. And we're going to push to cover that for the ladies. Amen? And we're going to try to bless them, so we're going to raise all the money and make all the barbecue and make all the good food. And if I have to put Kyle out to wash some cars, I don't mind doing that. So let's get together as a community, as a church, and send our wives and our sisters off to worship the Lord in a great place, Woodland Park, Colorado, under Andrew Womack's ministries. Amen. So that's all I have. Let's go ahead and I would like everybody to just stand up and just stretch those legs. Welcome each other. Welcome new people, and we'll get started with the word.
All right. Praise the Lord. That was good. So good. Thank you, Lord. That was really good what Pastor Sally shared. And I pray that we get a hold of that. And, you know, sometimes it takes some time for us to get a hold of these truths and to really understand God's heart. You know, on that issue of giving and handling money. And I think sometimes we treat it like it's kind of voodoo in the church. You know, we're, oh, we don't want to talk about money, or, but, you know, we deal with money on an everyday basis. Amen. So, you know, I know we went a little bit longer than usual on tithe and offering, but I think it was worth it because I think God put something in Pastor Sally's heart that really God wanted to get out for us, you know. So hopefully that launches us into just understanding more of God's grace when it comes to giving, and not just giving, but how to handle money, and just so we can, God's whole purpose for us is to be blessed to be a blessing, right? So if we're barely getting by on our finances, you know, how are we going to bless other people? And that's the whole purpose in God getting stuff to us, is so that we can be a blessing. Amen? So, you know, praise God for God's heart on that. How many of y'all are ready to get into the Word today? All right. Let's do it. I like that. I like that big amen. Praise God. That means we're ready. It's going to be good. Father God, we thank you for this morning. And what a privilege and pleasure it is to jump into your Word. And we just thank you that your words are going to jump off the page to us, and they're going to minister so mightily to our soul. We thank you that this morning, God, you're going to lead us to those green pastures, to that still water that you talk about in Psalm 23. And we thank you that it's going to be good and nourishing for us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So let's jump over here to Acts 16:16. Acts 16:16. The title of today's message is Grace That Never Stops Fighting. Grace That Never Stops Fighting. How many of y'all are thankful for the grace of God? Amen. Now, I will be honest with you. I am continually learning about God's grace in my life. Because, you know, the moment that I think God's grace has done everything it's going to do for me, I see a new dimension and a new side to God's grace. I see God's grace go even further and deeper in my life. And I pray that we would seek to understand God's grace even more, because there is more grace. Somebody say, more grace. There's more grace for you. And the reason that grace is so special and important to the believer is because we cannot receive anything from God apart from His grace. Amen? We will never deserve anything good from God. Every single thing that comes from God is by His grace. Amen. Hallelujah. So, and instead of trying to twist God's arm to try to give us stuff, or we need to understand grace and how it works and how it operates and how we receive it. So, anyways, I'm thankful for God's grace, and we're talking about grace that never stops fighting for us this morning. So let's start here in Acts 16:16. Now it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with the spirit of divination met us, you're talking about Paul and Silas, by us, met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune-telling. This girl followed Paul and us and cried out, saying, "These men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation." And this she did for many days. But Paul, greatly annoyed, he turned and said to the Spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And he came out that very hour. Verse 19, "But when her masters saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And they brought them to the magistrates and said, 'These men, being Jews, exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe.' Then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. And having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's chains were loosed." Hallelujah. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. So we see here how, you know, Paul and Silas, they had done a good work, and because of that good work they had done for the Lord Jesus Christ, they were put into prison and beaten. Why were they put into prison and beaten? Because they took away these people's fortune. That's how they got a fortune, right? From the fortune-telling of that girl. And they delivered her of that demon. Praise God. That's why I don't go to fortune tellers. Amen? That's why, you know, I don't meet with people who consult with the dead. Why? Because it's not the heart of God, amen, for the living to connect and communicate with the dead. That's not for us to do. So, So here Paul and Silas were beaten and put in a prison. And so you can just imagine how they were in prison. You know, when we think of prison, we think of American prisons, right? I mean, everything's cool, you know. I mean, I've never been to prison, but from what I hear from people who have, you know, everything's cool. I mean, it's not really that difficult. You know, you're fed well. The living conditions they're okay. I mean, they're not horrible, right? You get TV time. It probably depends on where you're at exactly, what prison you're in. But, you know, it's actually not that bad from what I hear. Some people don't even mind going to prison. Some people would rather be in prison than in the free world because they don't know what to do with themselves in the free world. I've heard that from people, you know. So, anyways, but these prisons were Roman prisons, and they were not the same as American prisons today. You did not want to go to prison because you were most likely to die there. Not because of the length of stay, just because of the conditions that you were in. You were likely to die. Imagine if American prisons were like that today. I would imagine criminals would not be so inclined to commit crimes if American prisons were like that today. I'm not suggesting that we go that route, but I'm just saying, you know, people would not want to go to jail or prison if it was like that. But anyways, the Roman prisons, you can imagine how Paul and Silas were. You know, they were beaten, they were bloodied, their clothes were tattered from the beating that they took. Amen? And, you know, I would imagine there was a low oxygen level in the prison because it says they took them to the inner prison. There were no windows or anything like that, and it was very, very overcrowded in that time. The prisons were very overcrowded. So here you have all these people sucking up oxygen in this place that doesn't have any windows or anything like that. And so I would imagine the oxygen level is low. It's crowded. It's stinky. I'm sure the guards, the Romans, they don't care about, you know, cleaning up and things like that. The prisoners are there to die pretty much. So it's stinky. You know, Paul and Silas, they have these heavy chains around them. It's dark. Now, I was reading up on Romans prisons, and they say that it's almost pitch black in the inner prisons. I mean, it's super dark. I'm sure they were hungry, really hungry, right? I mean, that day they went to prayer, and, you know, I'm sure they haven't eaten. And what I read about in the Roman prisons is that, you know, oftentimes the Romans really didn't even provide the prisoners food. It was dependent upon the people that the prisoners knew to bring them food. They didn't provide food, right? So I'm sure, you know, they were hungry, and they were just weak. I'm sure they were weak in their body. I'm sure they were, you know, kind of beaten mentally. But despite all that, Paul still praised God. He still praised God, you know? I mean, man, that had to take some faith, didn't it? Because there was no reason for him to be praising God. You know, for all Paul knew, he was gonna die there, right? Paul didn't know any better, you know? And so, anyway, so Paul still praised God because no matter what, you know, his situation looked like, God is still faithful. And that's what we need to realize, too, is that no matter what our situation looked like, you know, I'm pretty sure that none of us have ever been in that position, in that situation. Maybe you have. I would like to talk with you after service if you have, because I want to hear that story of how you got there. But I'm pretty sure none of us have been, you know, in that situation. And it's funny, you know, in America, we we don't face that much persecution. I mean, we're facing more and more persecution, but it's all verbal, right? It's not physical. And so man, we need to understand that God is faithful. In Hebrews 6:18, it says there that it is impossible for God to lie. Amen? And in Romans 5:8, it says there that he loved us when we were still sinners. He loved us when we were still sinners. So that tells me that no matter what, God always loves me. Amen? And I believe that's what Paul and Silas were holding on to. They weren't focusing on the chains or, you know, the darkness or the stinkiness or the gashes all over their body from being beaten. They weren't focused on that. And they were, you know, they had a risk for major infection too. I mean, they were beaten. It's not like the wounds were cleaned or anything. And they were around all these people with all these germs and just nastiness in the prison, not being cleaned and sanitized. And, you know, they were in trouble of getting infected and stuff. But, you know, Paul and Silas, they didn't focus on that. They focused on the faithfulness of God. And God says, I love you. And it's not the world's kind of love where God just feels love for us or feels sympathy for us, but it's real love. You know, it's real, genuine, authentic love to where God doesn't love us because of anything that we have done for him. He just loves us because that's who he is. He is love. And the one thing we have to recognize is that God never lies and God never changes. Amen? So God loves us through anything and everything that we will ever go through. Praise God. And that's why I believe Paul and Silas were praising God is because they are focusing on God's love. They are focusing on his faithfulness. Amen? And you know, I believe that Paul in his heart was saying right then and there, if my course ends today, that's fine. I died serving the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the mindset we need to have. If I died today, I died serving Jesus. Amen? How many of us can actually say that? I died serving Jesus. If I was to go today, I gave everything I had for him. If you can't say that, I would encourage you to get your heart right with God this morning. Amen? There's no life like living for the Lord. Praise God. He loves us. He loves us. And I love it that as Paul and Silas were focusing on God's love and focusing on his goodness and praising him, that's the only way you could praise him in a state like that, right, is to focus on God's love and faithfulness. And it says in verse 26, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, you know, and the foundations of the prison were shaken, all the doors were open, and everyone's chains were loosed. Praise God. It's like, this is amazing, right? And what I like to say is suddenly, in the Kyle Dunlap version of the Bible, maybe I'll write my own one day. No, I'm just kidding, I'm not. But suddenly grace showed up. That's the way I like to interpret this. Suddenly grace showed up when Paul and Silas were praising God. Suddenly grace showed up. How many of you guys have had grace suddenly show up in your life? Anytime God speaks to you, I'm telling you, it's grace. When God spoke to Pastor Sally and said, do you trust me? I guarantee you it was grace. Amen? When God showed up in my life, it's funny because God showed up in my life too, and he said, do you trust me? When I was thinking about going to Bible college and I didn't have the funds, and so I was like, you know, maybe I'll just wait till I have it all financially together and, you know, everything's perfect in the natural and then I'll go. But God says, do you trust me? Amen. Do you trust me? And so when God spoke that to me, spoke that to Pastor Sally, when he speaks to all of us, man, it's grace. Because God's trying to get us somewhere. You understand? God's trying to get us somewhere. He's trying to get something to us. Praise God. So suddenly, grace showed up. And when grace showed up, the foundations of the prison were shaken. And this is so beautiful. The doors were open. The chains were loosed. This is so beautiful because the moment that grace shows up in your life, whatever is holding you captive in your life, and I want you to just think about this for a second. Whatever you feel like is holding you captive, when grace shows up, grace literally grabs that thing that is holding you captive and shakes it by its foundation. It shakes it from its foundation. See, we got to recognize that God loves you. And love is not just a feel-goody, you know, la-la land thing. God is passionate about you. God is jealous for you. And God in his grace, when grace shows up in your life, God will take whatever it is that is hurting you, oppressing you, keeping you captive, and will shake it from its very foundation. Amen. And when something is shaken from its foundation, how many of you know it can't come back? Why? Because the foundation has been shaken. Thank you, Lord. That's what grace does. It shakes the foundation of whatever it is that is holding us captive. And it's just like, you know, I liken it to Moses, how Moses went to Pharaoh and said, the Lord says, let my people go. And I believe that's what grace says to us. Amen? Not to us, I'm sorry. Says to the prison, whatever prison you feel like you're in, it says to our prison, let my people go. Amen? When I've been stuck in life, which has happened quite a few times in my life, when I felt stuck and captive, amen? You know, grace shows up in my life and it says, you know, let Kyle go. Let Chris go. Amen? Let Liz go. Let Marie Lee go. Praise God. When grace shows up, it says, let them go. And, you know, sometimes whatever it is that's holding you captive, you know, it doesn't want to let you go, right? It doesn't want to let you go. But you know what? It has no choice because just like Pharaoh refused to let the Israelites go, God says, okay, you don't want to let my people go? I'm going to show you what's up. It's the Kyle Dunlap version. I'm telling you, I need to write a Bible one of these days in my own translation. But God said, I'm going to show you what's up. And he showed Pharaoh what's up. He destroyed Egypt. Egypt was a huge nation. I mean, it was. They were rich. They were powerful. And God brought Egypt to its knees very, very quickly. I mean, he just destroyed Egypt from the inside out. The Pharaoh is viewed as a god to the Egyptians, right? And God just completely destroyed everything about Pharaoh's life. God stripped Pharaoh of everything. He even killed his firstborn son. See, you have no idea, and I include myself in this, we have no idea how passionate God is about us and how much God loves us and to the extent that God will go to save us from whatever it is that is imprisoning us. That's the extent that God went for the Israelites. Amen? He brought a God to his knees and said, don't you ever, ever mess with my people when I tell you to let them go. Amen. God, you know, God takes it personally. If someone wants to mess with my kids, Asher or Sophie, and you know, Emma, I take it personally. Praise God. You know, I'm not a fighting man at all. And if you call me names and stuff, I'll forgive you. But if somebody says something about my kids or my wife, and it's time to take the gloves off. And how many of you can say amen to that? I know you guys, a lot of you guys, if you're not like that, you should be like that. You should be like that. I will swing first and pray for you later. Amen? I take it very, very personal. Do not mess with my kids or my wife. And I have confronted people before who have tried to mess with my wife. Not here, don't worry. It's in Colorado, things got a little bit crazy. Praise God. But God has called us, as men especially, and women, to protect our family. Hallelujah. And that's what we're called to do, brothers and sisters. You can put me down and stuff all you want, but don't mess with my family. And that's how God is. That's how God is. You know, people mock God every day. Did you guys know that? You know, you'll be surprised in social media and stuff. Oh, man, it is horrible. It's horrible. People mock God. I heard a song out the other day. I don't really listen to her, but from Ariana Grande, called God is a Woman. Yeah, it's called God is a Woman. And it's just so blaspheming, and it's just putting God down and making a mockery of God. And if you're an Ariana Grande fan, sorry, but she's mocking God, and she's blaspheming him. And, you know, people mock God and blaspheme him all the time, and in the world, in social media and stuff. And, you know, God lets that slide. God lets that slide for now, right? There'll be coming a time where God judges all sin. But you mess with God's kids, don't mess with his kids. Thank you, Lord. And God's that way when Satan comes to mess with us. Amen? Don't mess with his kids. God says, you know, the reason that God tells us you don't take vengeance on people. God says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. In other words, God says, I'm the perfect judge. You let me handle whoever it is messing with you. That's grace, brothers and sisters. Grace is there to protect you, to provide for you, to strengthen you. Amen? You can be feeling weak like Paul and Silas, but man, when you just focus on the love of God, all of a sudden grace just rises up within you. You feel that grace rise up within you, and you're overwhelmed by the goodness of the Lord, and you start praising God. Amen? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God takes it personally. He says, let my people go. Hallelujah. Grace will shake the foundation of whatever it is that is holding you captive when it shows up. Thank you, Lord. And this is the great thing about grace is that, you know, you can feel like all the doors in your life are shut. You feel like you're locked in the inner prison in your life. You feel like not only are all the doors shut and you're in the inner prison, but you even got chains on you. I mean, you're triple locked down in life, right? We feel like that sometimes, don't we? And all the doors opened. All the chains were loosed. Praise God. Everything. I mean, grace just, everything in your life can turn around just like that. And it's all because of grace. It's not by your effort. Amen? Thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now, what I want to talk about here in verse 25, it says, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. You know, and we view midnight, you know, midnight is the passing of the nighttime into a new day, right? And, you know, the thing that we need to recognize, and I believe that God is trying to speak to us here through Paul and Silas, is, you know, we need to not let our yesterday's problems or sins or mishaps or downfalls slow us down today. Amen? We need to not let those things slow us down today. And I think our problem is, let me go over here to Hebrews 12 first. Hebrews 12, verse 1. And, you know, many of us have heard these scriptures before, read them. Hebrews 12, 1, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside, somebody say lay aside, every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was before him, that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Thank you, Lord. Verse 3, for consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. So, you know, in verse 1 there we see it's easy to hold on to stuff in life, isn't it? It's easy to hold on to, you know, things that you've done wrong in the past. And I just imagine us just, the way I view it is I just imagine us clipping all these weights onto us. It's like, you know, in the gym they have those little clips that you can hook around the handles or whatever, and you start lifting weights with the cables and stuff. And that's what I imagine us as Christians, just, you know, all our mistakes, we just keep clipping one thing after another to us. And after a while we're just dragging all this stuff with us, you know, all our mistakes and everything, we're just dragging all this stuff with us. People who have offended us, we're dragging them along too. We're dragging all this dead stuff with us, and before long you're not going to be able to move. You're not going to be able to move. And you're like, God, where are you? God, where is your grace? But God's like, look, you need to unload some stuff. Amen? You need to forgive yourself. You need to forgive other people. You need to let go so I can move you forward. Amen. This is what God is speaking to us. And verse 3 there we see, for consider Jesus, who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged. So if we don't consider Jesus, what's going to happen? We're going to become weary and discouraged in our souls. And a problem in our life is that we're considering too much stuff besides Jesus. We're considering all the people who have hurt us, all the people who have hindered us, you know, and we just blame all our problems on them. We blame all our shortcomings on them. And so, you know, we consider all these things. We consider all the times we've failed. You know, we consider, you know, the divorces we've had, the people we've hurt, the all the bad words we've said. We consider all the things that we've done wrong, but we're not considering Jesus. Amen? We're not considering his grace. And the Bible tells us that's the one thing that you need to consider. Consider Jesus. And then what happens when we consider Jesus is that you will no longer be weary and discouraged in your soul. It's all about, what are we considering in life? Amen. This is what God is calling us to. Praise God. We're considering too much. Thank you, Lord. Now let's jump back over there, and I want to talk about this, you know, the midnight that Paul and Silas, not only do we learn from there that, you know, we need to release our yesterday's problems and mishaps and offenses. How many of you guys know offenses are going to come, okay? People are going to offend you, but you've got to let it go. You've got to let God deal with that person. You can't be holding that yourself. God didn't call you to bear such things. I know people are very offensive these days, but that's how people are, unfortunately. Amen? And the quicker that we realize that's how people are, the quicker that we'll understand. And life will be much easier for us. Life is so hard for us because we just expect the world or want the world to be perfect. Guys, we don't live in a perfect world. We serve a perfect God, but we don't live in a perfect world. And neither are we perfect. Amen? But our job is that we got to realize everything is a heart issue, and we've got to, you know, people just need Jesus. That's all it comes down to. We need Jesus, don't we? Everybody else needs Jesus. The person who offended you and hurt you needs Jesus. Amen? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. But Paul and Silas, I find it interesting that they were, you know, praising the Lord at midnight. Most of us, we'd be asleep at midnight, right? And here's the thing is that, you know, I think most of us, we get too comfortable in our captivity. I really do. I think we get too, maybe you fought at first against whatever it was that was holding you captive, but, you know, we get too comfortable in our captivity. And I believe that's why we stay captives to whatever it is that's holding us. It's because we get too comfortable. Thank you, Lord. We've got to understand that God's grace is not looking to set people free that like their captivity. If you like your captivity, God's grace is not for you. God wants to set you free. If you want to be a victim, God's grace is not for you. There is no victimhood in grace. Amen? If you want to be sad and down and depressed, because some people, you know, we don't like to think about that, but some people actually want to be down and depressed. Why? Because they want people's sympathy. You know, they don't want to learn. They don't want to change. They don't want to grow. They just want to stay the same. You know, they complain about their problems, but really they don't want their problems to go away, or else they would have nothing to talk about. You know? And for that person, God's grace is not for you. God loves you, but if you don't want to be free, God's grace is not for you, because there is only freedom and grace. There is no bondage. So if you want to be in bondage, God's grace is not for you. Amen. Praise God. We need to overcome in our, you know, mentally, we need to understand in our heart, we need to understand from God's word, God has called us to be an overcomer. Now, there are things that are going to come in life that can bring you down, you know, that will wear on you and weigh on you. But God wants us to be overcomers, and grace sets you free. Grace makes you an overcomer in life. Amen. No matter what you're going through. I mean, it's just like Paul and Silas. It doesn't matter what you're going through. Grace makes you overcome. Suddenly, grace appeared. Why? Because Paul and Silas wanted to be free. The reason I know they wanted to be free is they were praising God. They're worshiping God. Amen. It showed their heart. It showed where their heart was. And we're going to talk about a little bit later about, you know, the significance of that. Thank you, Lord. But in verse 25, let me go back there to Acts 16 and verse 25. I'm sure they got it up on the screen. Acts 16, 25. So, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. I think it's funny here, it says the prisoners were listening to them. Well, weren't Paul and Silas prisoners? I think it's interesting here, it doesn't say, and the other prisoners were listening to them. It just says, and the prisoners were listening to them. See, Paul and Silas, even though physically they were in prison, they were not in prison in their hearts. And that's what grace does for us. You know, it doesn't matter where you're at or what you're going through. You choose whether you're going to be taken captive or not. You choose whether you're going to be imprisoned or not. Are you going to submit to whatever it is that is coming against you, or are you going to trust in God and believe Him? You can be in prison physically, but their heart was free. They were not prisoners. Paul and Silas were not taken captive. Remember what Jesus said to Pilate? He said, you know, Pilate said, you know, why don't you talk? He was questioning Jesus, you know, considering whether to crucify him or not. And he says, why don't you talk? Because Jesus wasn't saying anything. Hallelujah. He went to the slaughter silent. So Jesus wasn't saying anything, and he was asking him all these questions, you know, are you the king of the Jews and all this stuff? Jesus wasn't saying anything. And he said, don't you know that I have the power in my hands to kill you or to let you live? And Jesus said, you don't have anything in your hands that the Father has not given you. Amen. Amen. And I'm sure that's the way that Paul and Silas thought. You know, they said, you know, we maybe have been beaten, we may be in prison, but God is our God. And God has our fate in his hands. Amen? And if God wants me free, I will be free. If God wants me to minister more, I will minister more. If this is the end of my course, so be it. But no matter what, I'm going to praise God. Amen? And of course, God set them free. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God for his grace. Thank you, Jesus. They were not prisoners. And we should never let our circumstances in life take us captive. Amen. The Bible says in John 8:36, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. We don't need to fall victim to anything other than grace, because only grace can set us free. Hallelujah. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, quickly, I want to go over here. You know, Paul and Silas, they were in prison because of persecution, right? They were doing the Lord's work. They were doing good things. But, you know, what about when we're imprisoned for our idiocy? What about when we get in, between a rock and a hard place because of bad decisions we've made? And I've been there. I think, you know, you probably all have, but I'll just be the first one to raise my hand. I have been there. But I have put myself in bad situations because of my lack of judgment, my lack of trust in the Lord, you know? But grace is still there for you. Grace is still there for you. Not just when you're, you know, people do bad things to you or persecute you, but grace is there for you when you do bad things to you. And you put yourself somewhere, right? Grace is still there for you. So I want us to look at a few examples, and we're not going to turn to these scriptures, but, you know, you can study them later. In John chapter 21, we see that grace restored Peter when Peter rejected grace. The Bible says Jesus came to declare grace and truth. okay? He can manifest grace and truth. Peter, when Jesus was being led to be crucified, or to be judged to be crucified, Peter denied Jesus three times. Peter denied grace. He rejected grace. And yet we see in John 21 that Jesus restored Peter. Grace restored Peter, even after Peter had rejected grace. And Jesus said, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, Lord. After three times, Jesus said, feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Peter said, yes, every time. Lord, you know I do. You know my heart. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Amen. Grace restored Peter when Peter had rejected grace. In John chapter 8, grace restored a woman who was best friends with grace's enemy, which is sin. You know that sin is grace's enemy. And this woman, the woman in John chapter 8, the woman caught in adultery, she was fellowshipping and she was fellowshipping with sin, sexual sin. And yet grace restored her. Amen. Sin is grace's biggest enemy. And here this woman was, partaking and fellowshipping with grace's enemy. And grace still restored her. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Romans 5:20, the Bible says there that where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. And I'm here to tell you that you cannot out-sin grace. It's not like God has a limit, like, oh, you've sinned this many times, there's no more grace for you. It's grace. And grace comes from God, and God is infinite. God is eternal, so God's grace is infinite and eternal. Amen? You can't out-sin grace. Are we crazy? we're limiting God too much. We're thinking too small of God. You can't out-sin grace. Thank you, Lord. But I'll tell you one thing. I'm not going to try to out-sin grace because I'd rather just live in grace. Amen. But there are times when I have sinned, and man, I felt like I had out-sinned grace. Anybody y'all been there? You know, you feel like you've out-sinned grace, but man, you just need to see the truth. See the truth. Consider Jesus, and he'll say to you, you have not out-sinned my grace. I still love you. I've still got grace for you. Amen? In John chapter 4, we read about how grace reaches out to the lowliest of the lows. We read about the Samaritan woman. And first of all, she had a strike against her because she was a Samaritan, right? She was a half-breed. A Samaritan is essentially a Jew who consummated with a Gentile, and that's how you got the Samaritan. And so the Jews looked down on the Samaritans. They looked at them as half-breeds. And anyway, so this lady was a Samaritan. Not only that, but she had been with so many men before. Right? Jesus said, you know, you've had five husbands, and the man you're with now is not your husband. Right? So she got around in Samaria. And so, you know, back then, maybe not today. Now, today, you know, that's seen as normal, right? In America, it's just like, if you get around, you're, you know, that's normal. Oh, you're just a normal teenager, just a normal young adult, just getting around. That's not normal. That's not normal, brothers and sisters. And we've got to stand for the truth, and we've got to stand for God's word, what God's word says. You know, it's not normal to have sex before marriage. That's not normal. In the world, it's normal, but God has called us to be separate and different. Amen? This is what God has called us to. So, anyways, so this lady, you know, she was greatly looked down upon back then in those days. You know, they had some morality, and there was a lot of immoral things that took place, don't get me wrong. But they had that morality at least, to where they pretended at least to have that morality, to where they looked down upon that kind of thing, you know? And here this lady is the lowliest of the lows. And yet grace reached out to her. Jesus reached out to her. Just her at the well. It's like God sent Jesus, the almighty creator, the almighty maker of heaven and earth. God sent Jesus to minister to this one lady who was the lowliest of the low. I just think that is so amazing. That God thought of this one lady. And God sent his own son to minister to this one lady. Sometimes we feel like God just leaves us on the side of the road, broken where we are. We don't understand grace. Because God sent his son to minister to this one lady who was nothing. I mean, she was nothing. And I don't know about you, but there's been many times in my life where I have felt like nothing. I felt like I've let the Lord down, even as a Christian. Not just talking about before Christ. I'm talking about, you know, after Christ. I just felt like I let God down, and I just felt like nothing. But God does not leave us broken on the side of the road. God is graceful. He's always pursuing us. He's a jealous God. He loves us. Amen? He's always pursuing us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now we're going to jump into the Old Testament a little bit here. In Daniel chapter 6, we read about how the God, by his grace, he shut the mouths of the lions so they wouldn't consume Daniel. In Judges chapter 8, we read about how God used Gideon and 300 Israelites to defeat a Midianite army of 135,000. 300 men defeated an army of 135,000 in Judges chapter 8. You can go read about that. It's amazing. The grace of God accomplished that. Amen. They didn't earn that win. They didn't earn that win at all. The grace of God accomplished that. In Joshua chapter 6, God destroyed the impenetrable walls of Jericho. People inside of Jericho, they were, you know, mocking the Israelites. You guys are never going to get in here. I don't care how big your God is or what armies you've captured so far. You're never going to get in here. And God just completely destroyed the walls of Jericho, the mighty walls of Jericho, with a shout from the Israelites. You know, and we, when we read that in Joshua 6, we think, oh, the shout must have been so loud that the walls crumbled. No, there's not a shout that's going to be loud enough to make, you know, walls crumble. You ever been to a football game? Right? Everybody's screaming. You don't see the everything just destroyed and fall apart. And I guarantee you the walls of Jericho were just as strong as the stadiums that are built today. It was strong. Amen. So it wasn't the roar that destroyed the wall of Jericho. It was the grace of God. Amen. But when they let out that shout, Joshua and the Israelites, that was a shout of victory. And sometimes, you know, I just want to encourage you. When you're feeling down and defeated and you feel like, you know, my enemy is mocking me, but he's hiding behind these walls. When you just feel like whatever it is that's going on in your life that's just coming against you, and you feel like I can't penetrate the walls, I can't get through, I can't overcome it, just shout. Amen? Just shout. I mean, just sometimes enough is enough, isn't it? And sometimes you just got to stop thinking about how you can process this and process that and overcome. You know, you just got to stop thinking and just shout from your spirit. You understand? Not just shouting, just from your spirit. You mean it. Just something, just, you're just putting the enemy on notice. Like, I've had enough. Amen? Sometimes you just got to shout. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. So whether you feel like you're surrounded by lions, whether you feel like you're outnumbered by your enemy, whether you feel like, you know, you're never going to get through something because it's just too hard. You know, maybe your parents couldn't overcome that. Your grandparents couldn't overcome that. It's just too hard for you to overcome. I'm telling you that God, by his grace, you can overcome anything. You can beat up any enemy. Amen? You've got to start believing in the grace of God in you. We're seeing Christ as being outside of us, and that's why there's no power in our life. Christ lives in you if you have received him as your Lord and Savior. He lives in you. And you have power. You have grace. Amen. You have this. We need to start tapping into it. What do we have? Tap into what we have. Amen. That's what we've been talking about on Wednesday nights. You've already got it. What have we got on the inside of us that we're not using yet? Praise God. Too many times Christians we're allowing our situations and circumstances to defeat us. And we've got to know who lives on the inside of us, what we have. Amen. Amen. Now quickly here, I want to mention, we can all stand this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Mizao, can I have you come play, please, brother? You're a blessing. I quickly want to mention here that, you know, there are two things that we need to enter into God's grace, okay? Because here's the thing. God's grace doesn't just show up to anybody. I know this may sound weird to you because we've been taught in church that God's grace is for everybody, and it really is for everybody. But God's, you know, so then we ask the question, well, You know, if God's grace provides us this victory, why aren't all Christians experiencing victory? Well, it's because not everybody's entering into God's grace. Amen? There are two things we need to enter into God's grace, and it doesn't have anything to do with what you do. It's a heart. It's a heart thing. God's grace is all about your heart. God's grace will suddenly show up to those who have the right heart before the Lord. I'm not saying you're living right. I'm not saying you deserve grace, because we don't. But here's the thing. Faith and humility are necessary to enter into the grace of God. Faith and humility. That has nothing to do with how righteous you're living. Nothing to do with how holy you're living. Okay? But faith and humility. In James chapter 4, verse 6, the Bible says there that God gives grace to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. What does that mean? That means there is no grace for the prideful. The prideful God resists. You ever wondered why God only gave grace to Noah? Noah's Ark, right? Why did Noah find grace in the eyes of God? Go and read it. Why didn't somebody else find grace in the eyes of God? Why did Noah specifically find grace in the eyes of God? I don't believe that Noah was this perfect person by any means, but I believe that Noah had a heart about him that found grace in the eyes of God. Not everybody is finding grace today. Because their heart is wrong. And they don't want God. They don't want the truth. They don't want freedom. There's no faith. There's no humility there. And that's all we need, is faith and humility. In Ephesians 2:8, it says, by grace through faith are you saved. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. Amen? Somebody say faith and humility. That's how we enter into the grace of God. Amen. God's grace is so important for us. It sets us free. And not only does it set us free, but it allows us to set other people free. You read about the woman in John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman. And not only did Jesus show grace to her, but what happened? She went back to her hometown and she shared the grace of God with them. And so many believed. So many believed. God used this woman. He showed grace to her, and she went and showed grace to her hometown and said, come hear this man who told me everything that I've ever done in my life. You know what's amazing about that? Jesus told her everything she's done in her life, and yet Jesus still loved her. See, we think, man, if God knew everything I've done, you don't think God knows everything you've done? God knows everything you have thought, everything you have thought about thinking. God knows everything, and yet God still loves us. God is still graceful. God is still calling you. God still has a purpose for you. But it takes faith and it takes humility. Amen. The woman didn't deny Jesus. She didn't reject Jesus. She embraced him. She said, you must be a prophet. Thank you, Lord. Paul and Silas, when you know, all the prison doors were open and the chains were loosed and the prison was shaken from its foundation, they could have just escaped right then. And the keeper of the jail, you know, he was going to kill himself because the Romans were going to kill him anyways if they found out the prisoners escaped. So he was just going to kill himself and just get it over with. You know, that was a more honorable way to die. And Paul, instead of escaping and saving his own hide, you know what he did? He showed grace. Paul purposely, go read it in Acts 16, Paul purposely stayed in the prison. And he said, don't kill yourself, don't harm yourself. I wonder how Paul knew that the jailer was going to harm himself. Because it was dark. It was dark. It was so dark, the jailer, you know, when Paul screamed that out and said, don't worry, we're all here, don't harm yourself. The jailer said, bring me a light that I may go to Paul. It was so dark, the jailer needed a light to make his way to Paul. How did Paul know the jailer was going to kill himself? By the Spirit of God, I believe. The Spirit of God showed him that. I don't think there's any other way Paul could have known. And Paul showed grace, and he said, you know, I could save my own hide right now, but I'm not here for myself. I'm here because, you know, he's there because he is persecuted, But man, God can use any and every situation you're in to bring glory to Him. And that jailer needed Jesus. He needed Jesus. And Paul was in the right place at the right time. And because Paul was at the right place at the right time, that jailer gave his life to the Lord. He came and fell down before Paul, and he said, "What do I need to do to be saved?" And Paul said, "Believe on Jesus." And the man believed on Jesus. And the jailer took Paul to his house, and he cleaned up his wounds. And all of the jailer's family was saved. A whole family's life turned around, creating a generation after generation of believers. Why? Because Paul chose to not just receive grace, but show grace. He could have ran. He could have escaped. But it wasn't about him. It was about Jesus. And how many of us in life, we're making it about ourselves. We're making it about ourselves, and we're getting ourselves into so much trouble when we need to submit to God, have faith, and humble ourselves and say, "God, it's about your grace. It's not about me. It's not about what I've done. It's not about all the bad things that are in my heart right now." Because you may feel like I have so many bad things in my heart right now. It's not about that. It's not about that. God will clean your heart up. God will clean your life up. But He just needs you to believe in Jesus and humble yourself. Amen? That's all He needs. So if you're in here today and you say, "Jesus, I want to become a part of your family. I want to repent of my sin. I want to humble myself right now. And I want to have faith in you. I want to believe on you and enter into your grace." If that's you, I just want you to go ahead and raise your hand right where you're at right now. Thank you, Lord. Don't be ashamed. Don't be hesitant. Don't be afraid. If that's you and you're saying, "Jesus, I want to give my life to you," raise your hand right where you're at. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Father. Praise you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I just want to pray over, I'm going to pray over all of us here in a minute, but, you know, specifically, I just feel in my heart, like I'm just being drawn to Tori and Noelia for some reason. And I just want to impart something to you guys. You guys don't have to move, just stay where you're at, but I just want to impart something to you guys, because I just want to let you know that you guys are amazing, first of all. You know? And I don't feel like maybe you guys don't get told that enough. But you guys are amazing. And God had created you all for something special. And I don't want you to be so concerned about your appearance and how others view you and think about you. I want you to just look at your heart. I want you to just look at the inside of yourself and just, God loves you so much. And He cherishes your heart so much. He just... What makes you precious and so amazing is not anything on the outside, it's what's on the inside of you. And no matter what you've been through, no matter what's gone on, I just want you to know that God loves you and He still thinks you're amazing. You know? Sometimes we make decisions and go through things to where we don't feel as amazing anymore. And so, you know, I don't know if this is ringing true with you guys, but I know sometimes we try to make ourselves look even greater on the outside because of what we're lacking on the inside. But I want you to know, you don't have to do that. You don't have to do that. Amen? All that matters is what God thinks about you. It's not about being the hottest girl or, you know, being the smartest girl or being the hardest working girl. It's not about any of that. It's about God and what He thinks about you. And you know, when you were being formed in your mother's womb, you didn't do anything. You looked like a little alien there. You know, God loved you. Honestly, God loved you. When you were all creepy looking in your mother's womb, being formed, God calls you by name. And I just want you to know that. Amen. Father, I pray a blessing over them in Jesus' name. And I just pray, God, that they would know know the love that you have for them and be confident in that. Help them, God, not to deviate from your plan for the life, not to deviate from the course that you've laid before them, but God, that they would have a heart after you like never before. They would awaken to the truth of Jesus Christ and his love for them and his passion for them. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. Let's just raise our hands to the Lord right now. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We praise you right now, God. You are a good God, and you always will be. And your grace breaks all of our chains in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Sometimes you just got to raise your hands, just acknowledge how good God is. You just got to relax. You just got to let him minister to you. Amen? Sometimes you just got to live in awe of who he is. Thank you, Lord. You are forever faithful, and we are forever grateful for your faithfulness and your love in our life. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you for everyone here. I thank you that we are blessed as we go today. May we be a vessel of grace to show grace to those in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. I love y'all. Don't forget, this coming Sunday, service at 10:30. We got a bilingual service with Pastor Jerry Garcia. It's going to be amazing, all right? So be expecting big things. And we got a potluck sign up in the back if you want to bring some food after next week's service. God bless you.